Niggas was just laughing at me a little minute ago. Now nigga got, you know what I mean, tapers, that's blend game, you feel me?
Butter!
Blend game smoother than PowerPoint transitions, you feel me?
Talking about that east side, nigga, with that east side, nigga, with that east side. Your eyes speak the truth with everything else.
Hawk, I'm about to get on big bullshit, but you my nigga, though. All
right. Come on, man.
Can I get some of what y'all drinking, man?
Leave that alone. Leave that alone, bro.
Boy, that boy over there drinking apple cider vinegar.
Sparkling cider.
That nigga clearing the system out.
Man. Yeah. That boy on a master cleanse.
Nigga about to need a diaper in this bitch.
Well, welcome to the After Party Podcast. I'm your boy, After Party E.
Yeah, and I'm Talu, man. I'm in the building.
Hey.
And it's your the barber.
Don't do that. Don't ever do that on my show. Don't ever introduce yourself before I introduce you. Whoa. Yo, I swear that's the first time that's ever happened.
Hey, shit. Yeah.
Hawk, don't do that shit.
Wow, man.
Yo, no, don't do that. Yo, and we got my homie, my high school friend, the best barber in America, man, a celebrity barber. I don't even know what else to say. All I can say is my homie. We got Hawk the Barber here, man. The only nigga that'll introduce himself before I can introduce you, man.
Listen, man. It's your boy.
Let him know.
Hawk the Barber Prodigy here, man. Yeah.
Let him know, man. Now, Hawk, we always start off the interviews with who is the guest. So who is Hawk the Barber Prodigy?
Hawk the Barber Prodigy, man. Young boy Joshua Hawkins, coming from Cincinnati, Ohio. Like I said, man, I moved down to Atlanta about 8 years ago. Do I got to hold this mic?
Nah.
Yeah, okay, okay,
Hawk,
okay.
That's exactly what that stands
that's
for.
That's what the stand is for. Back that shit up a little bit, man. God damn. But yeah, man, you know, coming from Cincinnati, Ohio, moved down to Atlanta, Georgia about 8 years ago. Like I said, been killing shit, you know, doing my thing. Started off cutting hair back home. You know, I think it was Asia. 15, 16, when was I fucking y'all heads up?
Yeah, it was definitely.
It was fucking my heads up around
15, 16. Yeah.
It was all right, though.
That's what's crazy.
I could have sworn I pushed your shit back a couple
times.
Yeah,
but what's crazy is, like, I didn't notice at the time. I didn't notice you had pushed my shit back.
Right.
Until I look now, and I'm like, yo, yeah, Hawk definitely pushed my shit back.
That's why it took a little longer this time to fix that shit. But I got this nigga right, though.
Hawk, don't do that on camera. Don't do that.
My nigga, man.
Nah, but that's crazy though. Like that, I feel like it's amazing for us to see your growth. For us to see you go from cutting everybody in this room's hair in your garage,
yeah,
to now, Mr. $60 an hour.
Man,
yeah, that shit crazy.
Like, that's amazing. But the crazy thing is, it's like since I've known you, it's always been Atlanta was the goal.
Yeah.
Like, why Atlanta? Why was that always like, I gotta get to Atlanta?
Well, my mom, she had been living in Atlanta since I was probably like, 4 years old. So, you know, back home, my pops raised me and my brother, but we used to go down to Atlanta all the time and, you know, go visit and shit like that. And I think when I was like, 16, 17 years old, I came down to visit her and I ended up running to a guy who had a shop. And the shop that he had, he let me cut in the front. And like I said, I was making $700, $800 a week. So you talking about being 16, making $700, $800 a week. I mean, shit, I already knew where I was trying to be at. You feel me? So, you know, making that move, it wasn't no hesitation in that. It was just like, shit, I mean, being 16 years old, making that type of money and not even having no type of clientele to jump into that, yeah, it was crazy.
Yeah, you said, like, earlier, like, you knew, like, this is what you wanted to do, but you said your mom was disagreeing with that. Like, how was that, like?
Well, yeah, when I moved down, you know, of course, like any other parents, you know, they want you to, you know, go to college. They want you to, you know, get the top degree and all that shit. But, you know, when I stepped down, she wanted me to become a dentist. And I'm just like, you know, that shit, that ain't what I signed up for.
Where she get dentist from? Like, wherever she get there from? Like,
you know what I mean? I don't know. But
mama's just be coming up with anything.
They want to see their baby do the, you know, top thing. But she ain't know, her boy was going to do her, you know, crazy things with the cutting hair shit. And like I said, you know, we had our battles, but shit, I fought through it. And like I said, stuck it out. And like I said, it got crazy with them clippers, man.
That age, it get crazy, man, because people is creative nowadays. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, back when we was younger, like, you want to find the celebrity barbers. Like, it was hot. It was barbers that was hot. Everybody knew to go to them. Mm-hmm. But it's that social media that put people on a whole pedestal. Like, have social media helped you out, like, along
most the way? Definitely. Most definitely. Like I said, any class I done been to, any state, city, out the country, like I said, that's one of the main things I preach is to pretty much, you know, be real hard on social media. And it don't really matter what business that you do. You know, if you focus in your business and your craft, you know, and pushing that shit on social media. I mean, like I said, I pick up clients that's in South Africa, Australia, Dubai. You know, I'd never be able to touch these people with a business card because I'm here in Georgia. But at the same time, with that social media, I'm able to reach out to people that's all across the world, and they still able to come in and get, you know, that hawk sauce and get freshened up and shit like that. So,
yeah. Well, like, when did you know?
Hey, man, like, hold up, man. Why my mic ain't sitting up, man? What the fuck is going on, man?
You don't know what you're doing with it.
Listen, man, lock my shit, man.
I got you.
You know what I'm saying?
Is that what you want
it? Yeah, man.
There it is. No gay shit, though.
All right, pause.
Anyway, no gay shit. But what I'm saying. Hey, Hawk, don't do that.
What
don't
is
do
he
that.
Doing?
Not today. Not on this episode, Hawk. Not on this episode, man. But, like, when did you know, like, barbering is for you? You know what I mean? Because, like, I feel since I've met you, which was at the age of, like, 15, 16.
Right.
You've always been on the barber shit. Like, when did you, like, realize within yourself, like, nah, this is exactly what I want to do?
Honestly, man, like I said, once I came down to Atlanta and I was able to get into a shop early at that age like that, man, like I said, the shit was almost like selling dope. So it's just like, I mean, you making $700 a week. Like I said, at that age, I mean, like I said, that's down there, you know, some dope boy type shit.
Definitely.
So to be able to touch that type of money, man, like I said, it wasn't no other job that I even thought about doing. Like, oh yeah, I'd be able to, you know, shit, work at UPS, you know, making that type of money. So I got, you know, other options. Nah, I was just like, nigga, fuck that, nigga. Shit, I can touch that type of money. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, was the goal always to be your own, like, was to own a shop? Was that always the goal, or was it just to get into the industry?
I mean, honestly, like, even when I stopped hooping, you know, and I didn't hoop, you know, our senior year, you know, I truly just prayed about it, man. I was just like, you know, this is really something I'm supposed to do. You know, God just let me, you know, really let me know, you know, this is the step you want me to take. And I say probably like 2 weeks after I made like a strong prayer about it, like, I woke up one early morning, when I was getting ready for school or whatever. And it was on the BET Inspiration Channel. I ain't never watched it. Like I said, you know, you see them little crazy passes wake you up. You know, you didn't watch BET Uncut. And good God! That shit come on. You be like, damn.
BET is the coldest for that. They used to go straight from BET Uncut to Inspiration. So I mean, Joel anything. Like,
I ain't gonna hold you. You scared the shit out of me, boy. You had me over here shaking like booty beads.
They used to go to sleep straight off from watching BET Uncut,
bro. And like I said, you get woke up with, and God said, why was you just watching BET Uncut?
Only thing about BET is pissing me off is when they used to be like, yeah, you know, and then they used to put them straight to sleep. All right, like,
come
that.
On, man. Don't touch my head, come on. I know you was trying to get that shit off, cuz. Come on, man.
To, you pissed me off earlier.
Don't do that shit again. I ain't be.
Don't do that. Don't fuck up this episode. You gonna piss me off.
Nah, but seriously though, man.
And
you know,
the head ain't got off his head the whole time we've been out here with him, bro.
That's a part of my man's head.
It's a part of the look, bro. But nah, seriously though, like I said, you know, I made the prayer, man, and a couple weeks later, like I said, the Inspirational Channel was on in the morning, and that was my first time witnessing Creflo Dollar. And Creflo Dollar was on there, man. And seriously, bro, like, no lie, I can't make this up, bro. Everything that I prayed about, bro, he was talking about that morning. And my pops came in the room like, yo, you getting ready and everything? You know you got to get up out of here. And I'm like, yo, son, I just need to listen to this. I'm writing notes down. He's like, yo, this is all right. Do your thing. Whatever. So everything that I wrote down, man, was literally, like, speaking to me. Like, God was speaking to me like, yo, cutting hair is what you need to do. And like I said, since you're gonna be doing this, I need you to take it to the max. And like,
that's what's crazy about that. Like, literally everybody that's really into religion, that's really into, like, being so spiritual, they always say, like, yo, I went to church this week and it feel like the preacher was speaking personally.
Motherfuckers that hear that shit and be like, I heard it, but I think I was tripping though, for real.
Nah,
like, you know what I'm saying?
That's
and
what
not
talking,
really,
bro.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Taking that message and running with it.
Well, that's the thing. Like, you know, sometimes like we hear the message, you know, we pray about something. And then, you know, what I notice is like us as people, we constantly pray about the same thing over mm-hmm. and over again. But when you do that, you show a lack of faith, because it's just like at the end of the day, if you pray for it one time, he said he'll do it for you. What you keep praying about the same thing for?
Right.
You get what I'm saying? It's just like pray for it one time. Now, all right, take the steps that you need to take to actually complete it. You get what I'm saying?
And a lot of times people will pray for things that's really not theirs. Like somebody will think like, okay, it's destined for me to be an NBA player.
Right.
So they'll pray like, God, please let me get to the NBA. But God's like, no, you're destined to be the best mm-hmm. accountant that on this side of the world. But you don't even know it because that's all you're praying about. Right. So I feel like people should pray for clarity rather than an actual blessing. Like, God, just give me clarity. Just give me the ability to see what is really mine.
Yeah, and that's huge, man. Like I said, anytime with, you know, especially with praying, man, that, you know, I tell people all the time, like, you know, if you asking for something, you know, it's, you know, social media has its, you know, its goods and its perks and all that shit, but it also has its negatives, you know, because a lot of people be on social media and they'll see something that somebody else got and they think they can have the same stuff. And it just goes, even with social media not being out, and if you walking down the street and you see somebody that got a business and they had a successful business, you like in your mind, damn, I could do that too because I like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, let me pray for that because I want the same thing. But us as people, we forget the steps that it actually but sometimes we forget the steps that it actually might take for you to get that. So you praying for it like, yo, I want that, and he might give it to you, but he gonna give it to you in a way like, all right, I'm gonna give it to you 2-3 years from now, but I'm about to take you through something so you can actually get it, and then that way when you get it, you can keep it.
Every blessing I've had has came after something that I thought was the worst thing I've ever been through.
Right.
Like, I've always went through something before I had a breakthrough. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, I've always been like, yo, what the hell am I going to do now? And then something great happened. Mm-hmm. Like, damn, like I really got through that. Like, I love that inspiration. But I want to tell a story of how me and you became cool. You probably don't even remember this.
Nah, I probably don't, man.
How me and you became cool was we both was trying out for the basketball team our junior year. And we was at like an open gym. No matter of fact, it wasn't even open gym yet. It was conditioning. And we was running. And I was dead tired after sprints. I'm like, man, I can't make it. Like, I'm done. And like, I was had my hands on my knees. Like, man, I'm done. And you came over and was like, come on, bro. Like, put your hands on top of your head, bro. Like, you can breathe. You can breathe better like that. Come on, bro. Like, I know you can do it. And I was like, bro, who is this nigga? Literally, I was like, bro, who is this nigga? Like, I'm dead tired, bro. Like, get up on my face. But then we ran again. We ran another suicide. And you did it again. Like, come on, bro. I know you can. I was like, I fuck with dude. Like, it wasn't a sense of, like, we all competing for the same position. We all trying to get on the basketball team.
Right.
But it wasn't even like that. It wasn't even like, yo, like, you can really take my position. Like, I'm going to let you drown. It was like, nah. Like, I see something in him. I'm a push, bro.
Yeah.
And like, that was like, I think that was the thing that was like, nah, like, I'm gonna be cool with this nigga. Like that's my nigga. Like, that was some cool shit.
That's what's up,
I had just moved to the city, and it was like, nah, like, bro, like, really on some cool, genuine shit. Like, I'm out here struggling, and we, you know, in competition for the same position, and bro, we're like really pushing me.
Like, I don't remember that.
That was something that really spoke to your character for me.
Yeah.
That was what, like, was like, nah, like, I fuck with this nigga.
That's what's up, bro. Yeah.
Do you remember that?
No, I don't remember that shit. And I doubt if you I doubt if you was a tired ass nigga. Just like I said, I think you was a quick nigga back in the day. But
I'll
tell you the story, bro. The shit was good, bro. It almost brought a tear to my eyes. Shit, I was like, yo, this nigga like trying to make this emotional shit right now.
No, I got a story later that'll bring a tear to your eye. Don't even let that stress you. Just Hawk, I got the stories. Trust me. I told you pissed me off before this episode started. I'm gonna get on big boy shit. But for now, I wanna get your story out to the people.
All right, man. Get it out to the people, man. Get it out to the people, man.
So my question is, like, I feel the term celebrity barber is like thrown around a lot.
Oh, most definitely.
What to you actually makes someone a celebrity barber? Is it the fact that you cut a celebrity one time and you're done, or what actually makes someone a celebrity barber?
Well, for me, you know, I most definitely used to chase the whole, you know, I want to be a celebrity barber, this, that, and the third, until I found out, you know, the true meaning of being a celebrity barber is not what people actually throw out, you know, exactly what you're talking about. Like, you know, barbers would be like, oh yeah, I'm a celebrity barber because, you know, they cut, you know, somebody that's well known, if it's, you know, rapper, you know, athlete, you know, whoever it might be, actor or whatever the case. But what I've noticed is, you know, for me, I'm a celebrity barber because I treat all my clients like celebrities. Mm-hmm. And then the fact that, you know, I've branded myself and I've made myself who I am, and, you know, God has, you know, got me to the point where I'm at right now. I'm the celebrity because people want to come see me. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? So I'm the celebrity barber saying, like, I want Hawk to cut my hair. You know, I done had people come in the shop to get a haircut, but the whole time they just like, F the haircut, can I just get a picture with you? You get what I'm saying? So yeah, that's what makes you a celebrity barber. You know, when you actually connecting with the community and you actually, you know, getting yourself out there and, you know, people are actually like loving what you're doing because you're just a positive influence on what they're doing in their life and you actually changing their life. Not just by saying just like, oh yeah, I was able to cut that baseball player, or, you know, I cut his hair and this nigga down there didn't even want to pay me the money because he thought he was a celebrity. Like, that's not a celebrity barber.
I've never thought of it that way. Yeah. As in, a celebrity barber not being someone that cuts celebrities' hair, yeah, but someone that is the celebrity.
Is the celebrity.
Yeah. And that was crazy, like, because, like, we're homies, so I've seen your growth, but to see people really ask for your autograph and to see people really gravitate to you, like, kind of like, it threw me for a trip, like, damn.
Yeah.
Like, Hawk is really a celebrity out here.
This shit crazy.
Yeah, it's humbling, man. You know, like I said, I just came off of a trip, you know, out in Brazil. First time out the country.
Was a lot of fake titties out there?
We say that one, you know.
Hey, that was a great curveball. You're getting good out here. I'm just saying. You're getting great out here. I'm going to tell you.
I do this quite often. You know what I'm saying? So you got to know how to.
I got some shit you're going to have to get ready for.
I'm going to be quick on my feet. But nah, honestly, though, like, you know, like I said, being out there, man, you know, it was humbling for me. You know, to have people literally coming up to me, you know, hands sweating, you know, tears in their eyes, you know, just ready to meet me, like, damn, you know, I got you out here, like, you in my country, you know, for me to never even place foot in that country before and to see the type of, like, influence that I got, not just off of cutting hair, but just like, damn, you helped change my career or you made me want to cut hair and stuff like that, like, that's, like I said, for me, that is so humbling because, you know, it's a lot of other things that I could be showing people, you know, on Instagram or on social media. And, you know, I try to preach it to a lot of other guys that I do see that, you know, take it left, you know, left field and not necessarily always showing the most positive things. But it's just like when you are a leader and people are following you and do inspire people, you have to be a good influence. You get what I'm saying? Like, you got to watch what you put out there, man. So, you know, it's humbling to me, man, just to be able to see just like, you know, people that I never met before, people that I never came across before, you know, just be like at all with just like, damn. But, you know, at the same time, I still, you know, I still take it as, you know, it's just God shining through me, you know, so.
Yeah, most definitely. I want to know, like, who was the first celebrity that you cut? Like, the first
First celebrity that I cut, man, that's crazy because I didn't cut a lot of celebrities, and I include my clients with that. But if you're talking about just somebody that's well known that everybody might know, it was actually Allen Iverson.
Yep.
What the fuck?
Allen Iverson.
That was your first one?
That was my first one. I want to know how that get set up. Like, how did that get set up?
All right, so I was cutting.
I thought you were going to say somebody like that nobody knows, like Mr. Cheeks or some shit.
Common type shit.
Yeah, he got a Allen Iverson? That's
AI, bro. Yeah, it's AI. But now, I was cutting in the mall at the time, man, and we had just got in there, and we was always seeing this dude in there, man. Like I said, this dude ever see this video, you know, he probably gonna trip. But yo, this nigga was in the mall every day, bro. This nigga come in with, like, nigga just on some bummy shit, and then this nigga go get fresh, nigga, and leave out with a fresh fit. I'm like, yo, son, like, what you want, man? Like, this nigga bored, G. Like, yo, man, go do something, man.
So the mall,
like,
was this man's dressing
yo,
room.
Yo, it was his dressing room, bro. So I was like, I mean, that's fly shit, you know what I mean? You'll be able to go in the mall, you know what I mean? The mall is your closet. But
just leave the old clothes there.
You know, we was all packed.
You shit? Are you shitting me?
Are you for real?
Yeah. Come on, man.
That boy got broads in Atlanta.
No, but chill, bro. I got a whole ass girlfriend that just called me right here, boy.
That was girl, right?
Boy, yeah. Come on.
That was wifey, B. Yeah. That was wifey.
Come on, man. Y'all on some nut shit right now, man.
I like how you helped my man out because he was drowning. That was
wifey. Yeah, he was drowning. Come on, man. His drawers clapped together.
Goddamn.
The nigga Chase clapped together, B. That was real. That's how you know when it's wifey, B. When it's wifey, hey, that right there, like, listen.
This one, bro.
No, you not, bro.
She acting crazy, bro.
You're tripping. Man. Back to the Allen Iverson story. I'm sorry.
Yeah, so, man, you know, like I said, man, we was cutting in the mall, man. You know, a few other barbers was trying to get him up in the shop. And one day I was actually able to come across him and, you know, give him one of my cards. And, you know, he stuffed it in his back pocket. He looked at it, whatever. I was like, shit, at least he ain't throw it on the ground.
Yeah.
So I seen him later on that day. And like I said, I think he just came out from switching his outfits out or something like that. And he was walking with like two of his like homeboys, bodyguards, whatever. And I was like, yo, I was right in front of the shop. And I was like, yo, this is where the shop is at. You know, if you ever want to come through. And he just gave me this funky ass look like, why is this little hoe ass nigga still talking to me? So, like I said, me just being me, man. I like I said, as soon as I seen his face, I just had to say something. I was just like, hold up, son. Hold up. Before you start, you know, putting whatever in your head, son. Like, I'm asking you to come get your hair cut. Fuck all that other shit. And I said it just like that. Like, fuck all that other shit. And sure enough, the next day, that nigga came in was like, where that nigga Hawk at?
Damn, just like that. That's live.
That just sound like diligence and just confidence in yourself.
That's why he came and fucked with you, because, you know what I'm saying, just the way you came off, it was like, shit, I gotta come back.
I feel like cocky or arrogant people, or people that really have confidence, only fuck with other people that have that same type of confidence. Yeah, sure. You know what I mean? Like, if you're in your profession, if you feel like this is what you want to do for the rest of your life, and you don't have that same confidence about your profession as I have in mine, I don't want to deal with you.
Right? Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's what he saw in you, was like, man, this dude is cocky, but I want to fuck with him. Like, So what was that conversation like after that haircut? Like, did he say anything like, damn, this is crispy? Or like, what was the conversation
like? He was most definitely fucking with the cut. Like I said, once he seen the cut, he was just like, damn, you know, I ain't had nobody cut my hair like this. But man, one of my like first questions I had to ask him, I was just like, yo, why you do my nigga Jordan like that with that crossover? That was honestly, that was the first thing that came to mind.
You had to get the fam.
I was just like, yo, if I'm going to ask you anything, why the fuck Jordan had to get it like that? And this nigga, his answer was, nigga, everybody gets it. That's what he said. Everybody gets it.
That's a great mindset.
Yeah.
That's a great mindset.
Boy, like, Jordan almost smacked the shit out of him when he had reached.
That shit was...
he almost smacked the shit out of him.
As a barber, like, who was your Jordan? Like, who did you look up to? Like, damn, cuts are crispy.
That's tough.
Cut with some barbers, like the barbers that you used to cut with.
Yeah, because like you had a whole coalition.
It was like all of y'all was like some celebrity barbers.
Who was the one like that you looked up to for tips, or that you like, damn, I gotta compete with?
I mean, just like all around barber, man. And I mean, he'll know how I say this to this day. It's like I said, my brother Marcus Harvey, man.
I always see you with him, bro.
Yeah, like that dude right there, man. Like I said, he's a special cat. Like I said, and I tell people all the time when they ask about, like, you know, who is the best barber, or, you know, what would you consider a real good barber, it's more to it than just cutting hair. I know a lot of niggas that cut hair and they cut hair. You get what I'm saying? Like, they're not barbers. They're niggas who cut hair. You get what I'm saying? They might be real good, but they just cut hair. And, you know, I try to break that down a lot, where it's pretty much saying, like, you know, at the end of the day, when you trying to say you are, you know, a master barber is being somebody that's a servant. You know, good customer service, you know, being a positive role model, you know, being good with the clippers, but just all around the full package. So, you know, my homeboy Marcus, man, like I said, you know, he's taught me a lot. You know, when I met him, you know, yeah, I was nice with cutting hair and stuff like that. I was actually real quiet at the time, too, because for me, I was always like in my zone when I was at the shop, like, I was always in my zone. I ain't had to talk to nobody else. I was just doing my thing. So when I met him, He picked that up real quick, and he was just like, yo, like, you don't have to talk like way more, because who you are and your personality and how people look up to you, there's no possible way you could just be quiet all the time. Like, people want to hear what you got to say. Right. So when I would be in the shop cutting, he'd be like, yo, Hawk, I'm gonna just stop real quick. Me on this haircut. What you over there doing? Or what you think about this? And I'm like, yo, nigga, leave me the fuck alone, nigga. Like, you see me over here in this cut. But at the same time, he was opening me up to actually helping me getting prepared for the moments that I've actually, you know, encountered now. So, you know, it's huge, man. Like I said, you know, he's been a huge, like, role model for me, man. And like I said, you know, he know that. Like I said, yeah, he.
That's what's crazy, because, like, it's dope that you said that, because I feel like it's so much more to a barber. Barbers for, like, the therapy. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, they just want to talk about their situation. They're
psychiatrists out here, for
like,
real.
They want to talk about, like, what's just going on in the world. It's a whole feeling. Not even just the barber, but the people that's in there. It's like a conversation.
Yeah, it's where the people can open up, man. You know, like I said, being able to step into somewhere where you might not be able to do it at your job, because your job say this ain't the right place for that. You don't need to be talking about that type of shit here. You know, you try to do it with your family, but yeah, you know, whatever.
You got
to
hold punches.
Yeah, you got to hold punches. So when you able to come into a barbershop and actually, you know, open that up, especially at my shop that I got, you know, I allow people to have those type of conversations. I want people to dig deep. I want people to, you know, have knowledge to certain stuff that's going on. I don't want it to be like, y'all need to stop talking about that, because that topic, you know, it creates friction. I want the friction there, because, like I said, that's how you continue to learn. Like I said, you know, I think that's what held a lot of us back, man. You know, we try to, we don't need to talk about it. That's a touchy situation. Nah, fuck that. Talk about it. Like I said, that's how you grow.
I think that's dope about it, man. Like, I feel like that's dope that he brought that out of you, because it's something that I feel like only the people that are really close and in your circle have really ever noticed about you, because we know that about you. We know that you can have great conversations.
Funny as hell.
You're the type of person that was like, if I'm not super cool with you, then you really not going to know me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I feel like that's dope that he brought that out of you, man. Like, when did you realize, like, all right, I'm on, like, I am Hawk, like, to who you are today?
It's crazy, man, because I still talk about this shit to this day. When I started working for the company that I work for now, Babeless, you know, I never thought about working for a company as far as, like, a clipper company anyways. I always had my own vision on things that I want to do. But I started working for this clipper company, and one of the jobs that they have me doing is being a platform artist. And that's showcasing the clippers and actually teaching people about the clippers and teaching people about haircuts. So once again, you know, being at that stage where I was just always cutting hair in the shop and not really saying too much and just being to myself, and my boy Marcus was like prepping me, and I'm not, you know, knowing what was coming my way. I'm just like, okay, eventually I do have to learn how to start talking and, you know, mingling with people and shit like that. So for me to get that job opportunity after, you know, me working with my boy Marcus for a minute and then me stepping into it, I was just like, shit. Now I got to start talking in front of people and shit like that. And I'm looking around, I'm talking in front of, you know, it started off 20 people, you know, 50 people, 100 people. And then more and more people started to grow. And I'm just like, yo, like, you have to do this shit. So I did a show up in Cleveland, man. This was last year. And we did a few shows. Like I said, I was already kind of getting warmed up to it. But this particular show that I did in Cleveland, man, it was probably over 1,200 people, bro. And we had to go out there on stage. It was only three of us. And I went out on stage. And, you know, you always get this feel like, I mean, I'm pretty sure comedians get it, whoever, like, acting, shit like that, that you get this feel like, all right, I just need to go out there, but you get kind of nervous and shit like that. So once I got out there, you know, before I even started on the cut, I stepped away from the dude I was cutting. I stepped to the end of the stage, and I just looked around. And out of everybody's face that I was looking at, they was all just sitting there like, nigga, we came to see you, bro. So for me to see that, it was just like, damn, like, nigga, everything that you've been doing up to this moment, like, they want to see you. They want to hear what you got to say. So why not give it to them? So, you know, I stepped back, went to the guy that I was actually cutting. And everything just opened up, bro. Like, all the fear that I ever had of talking in front of people, all that shit went out the window.
The blessings that you receiving for this is crazy.
Yeah, man.
How do you stay down with this? Like, how did you, like, you know what I'm saying, from moving And we was young too, yeah. Like, you know what I'm saying? From moving out of Cincinnati, from out of high school, and then coming straight down here, and then staying with it. Like, man, a lot of people have fold up and been went back home or whatever. Yep. Like, how do you stay down with that?
Like I said, a lot of people would fold up. A lot of motherfuckers would have just been like, you know, they get big headed and shit. You know, a lot of stuff, you know, being successful, you know, a lot of people start getting to this point where they feel like celebrities, you know, and they get Hollywood and shit like that. And for me, my brother actually helped me with that. You know, when I was cutting in the garage, y'all might not have never known this, but when I was cutting in the garage sometimes, you know, I would do a dope ass cut that I thought was dope and probably spend like down there 3 hours on a cut or something like that. And I would try to go get him to come downstairs and look at the cut to get his approval. Like, nigga, what you think about this shit? Like, I just went hard on this shit. And every time I would do that shit, he'd be like, yeah, that shit cool. It's straight. And I'm like, this old hate motherfucker. Like, nigga, I just spent like 3 hours on this shit, damn it. And like I said, you know, he would just be like, yeah, I mean, that shit cool or whatever. So right before I moved to Atlanta, man, he was able to break it down to me. He said, listen, bro, you know, while you was in school and you was cutting hair, all your, you know, your niggas and your peers and shit like that was telling you you was dope. If you was looking for my approval to tell you that you was dope, you would have stopped trying to be dope. So he said, it don't matter who approval you trying to get or who you trying to be the dopest for. Never settle for, I'm just dope, nigga. Be the best that you can be at whatever it is that you trying to do. So I took that shit with me like, damn, like, that makes a good valid point. Like, it don't matter whatever blessings that I get, you know, whatever come my way, you know, whatever, you know, whatever it might be, you know, I always just look at it like, stay humble with it, you know, and just stay grounded, man, because at the end of the day, it could be taken away from you, you know, at a flick of a wrist, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But
I always thought that was dope about y'all relationship between y'all two, because it was always like, from the outside looking in, you always seen it was love.
Yeah.
But it was always like,
man, I couldn't stand that nigga.
Like, this is always my little brother.
Yeah, and you that's know what how I mean? It was too.
It was always that. No matter what we did, if we hooped, you could make 3 shots in a row and he'd be like, my nigga, you still whack.
Yeah.
I like that's just I love. Like, it like, was like, always like that little brother relationship. Yeah. Like,
I couldn't stand that nigga. Because now, like I said, I love my nigga to death, bro. But yeah, I mean, that's like I said, any siblings, man, you know, like I said, that was big bro. He 4 years older than me. You know, he was hard as fuck on me, but you know, at the same time, it still made me who I am today. You get what I'm saying? So, you know, it made a hard sell around a nigga. Like, you know, it's a lot to, you know, get to me, bro. Like I said, you gotta do a damn lot. So like I said, you know, I don't take nothing for granted. Like I said, you know, he was there while he was, you know, why he needed to be there to do exactly what he was doing. Yeah. Big brush.
Exactly. And that's what was appreciative about. You know what? I'm thinking on Big Bush. I got a funny Hawk story. You can't interrupt me. You gotta let me tell my
Come
story.
Come on, Shane. You know no, I'm interrupting.
No. Let me tell my story.
You start lying and shit, B. Like, I gotta
I promise,
nigga.
This story is 100% accurate.
All right.
I'm funny listening. Hawk story, all right? High school. We're at breakfast. This is before school start. We at breakfast.
I can get this on Snap.
Yeah, you can get this on Snap. Do your thing, because right, this is about to be some funny shit.
Take your time.
This is very accurate.
We putting this up? Well,
delete that picture, bro. But anyway, we at breakfast, right?
Hold on, let me get my Snap out, man.
I'm like, yo, like, and I was pretty pissed off. I'm like, bro, like, you know what? I seen this bad shorty on Urban Chat. Like, I can't wait to get back. You know what I mean? Like, to check my messages. This is 08-09 when Urban Chat was popping.
So, club chat.
So Hawk like, man, I don't know why you mess with that Urban Chat, bro. Like, that shit weak. I'm like, yeah, you right. Like, it is too many gay dudes on.
No, that's 60%
of my followers. No, now, mind you, we're not homophobic, but we're heterosexual. So obviously that's something that's gonna happen. Like, if it's too many gay people, I don't want too many gay dudes in my fucking DMs.
Gotta start this shit over.
So I'm like, man, it'd be too many gay dudes on Urban Chat. I gotta get off.
We're in Atlanta.
Hawk like, see, that's your problem. You giving out that energy. That's why they in your inbox. I said, no, Hawk. I said, they be on all that. They be sending out spam messages. He said, nah, I ain't never had one in my. I said, alright, whatever, Hawk. After school, we go back to my house. I get on my urban chat. I, you know, check my messages. Nothing. Hawk check his. One message. I'm like, Hawk, check your message, bro. He go there. Long behold, it's a dude. I'm like, Hawk, open the message. He's like, nah, I'm not opening that. So I tried to open the message. Hawk like, nah, don't open in that. So me and this nigga really started fighting for the computer. We wrestling. I end up opening it. He said, see, that's your problem. You always want to joke around. Now he gonna think I like him because it say red on the message. And he got so pissed and that nigga didn't take me to school for 2 weeks. I had to ride with Tyler. He said, see, since you want to be the funny guy, you can ride with Tyler to school.
Hey, man. Good story, man.
That's 100% accurate.
I don't remember this shit, but good story, man. I probably didn't take your ass to school for 2 weeks, but yeah.
I know you did it. I know you did it for sure. For sure. But that's just something that speaks to your character because you've always been this serious dude. Like, as much as you joke around, you're a serious-ass guy. You're a militant-ass guy.
Yeah, man, they say I'm about principle, man. It's just principle, man, so. Real principal type dude.
That's why I fuck with you, Hawk, because I feel like it's always been the opposite. I've always been this joking, funny dude.
That's how
I've
I am,
always
too.
Been this serious. Yeah,
play too damn
but he played, though. Like, like it was never.
But he played a serious fucking yeah, way.
He do. So, he went joking around. Like, you'd be like, damn, is bro for real?
Yeah.
Like, or is he not?
You never know, man.
So
you
he
never
started
know
laughing
Hawk,
with
man,
you. Like, this shit funny.
So, but like, what you been in Atlanta? Like, you spoke. You don't want to cut your Instagram live on this question. Wait till the next question. This is a serious, man. Yeah, like, this is serious. I want you to speak on this AIDS rock that you told us about.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. What is this AIDS rock?
I wanted to hear that again. That? Anyway.
Yeah, man. So you know, a lot of cats they want to come to Atlanta, man, and you know, get their freak on and shit like that. You know, it probably started around Freaknik times and shit. You know, niggas was popping. You know, bitches was out here doing their thing. But yeah, man, nah, it's real serious though down here, man, in Atlanta. I think it's rated number 2 for AIDS, like in the country, you know, and people constantly coming down here, you know, like I said, you know, doing their thing. But at the same time, like it's really something big. And I forget where the rock is at. I think it's like right next to the Coca-Cola building, but it actually has the exact number. Well, for whoever then actually got tested, it has the exact number for people who actually do have AIDS here and AIDS, HIV, whatever, you know, here in Atlanta. So, you know, it's something real big, man. And, you know, I tell people all the time, you know, most definitely strap up. Like I said, you're going to be out there having a good time. You know, ain't nothing wrong with it, but, you know, just strap up, you know, protect yourself and all that good stuff.
We sending that message to Brother O'Dev.
Yeah, O'Dev, you know, man, most Brother definitely, O'Dev, man. Because like I said, when you get, you know, good haircuts and shit, the Hawk sauce, you know, hey. It brings a lot of that yeah. shit to you, man. You know, so you just got to be careful, B.
You tell me what you told us. How many people have told you, like,
I've actually had a lot of clients. I would probably say 50%. I might be lying. It might be like 49. But I'm going to just say 50% to round that shit off. I'm going to just say 50% to round this shit off.
He's stupid,
but
nah,
I done had a lot of clients, man. You know, just very grateful of that Hawk sauce. And that Hawk sauce, if y'all don't know what that Hawk sauce is, you know, it is a product that I do sell. But at the same time, Hawk sauce is a brand, and Hawk sauce is every time I cut somebody hair, I put Hawk sauce on them, and that's actually my touch, my signature to say you just got hooked up with that Hawk sauce. And a lot of my clients been able to go out on dates, you know, with their young ladies or whoever they might go out on a date with, and be able to, you know, get some later on that night, you know,
off the call,
so I done had a lot of clients, you know, come in and be like, yo, Hawk, you a man, you my nigga for life, B, like, you know, last night I was with this baddie, you know what I mean, after we got done getting it in or whatever, she was just like, yo, you need to go to your barber and thank him because your hairline was just, yeah, it was nasty. So, you know, I do that a lot, man. And I don't have a problem with doing that, man. I'm just saying, man. I'm a giving guy, man. I love giving, man.
I'm going to have to come back with another, for, you know what I'm saying, for another cut. Because we got hella hot sauce done.
Yeah, I don't know if y'all can see it right now.
Yeah, yeah, we got hella. It's too much sauce. Yeah,
after party E got the fro cut off.
We didn't finally cut this nigga hair, man. It's too much sauce. He was doing his do the right thing, but we really got him doing the right thing now. You know, he wanted some black people on that wall. You know, no more Sal's Pizza. If nobody, you know. But like you said.
Hey, brother Odev, cut my man's mic off. Yo, I wanna thank everybody.
Now, you know what I mean?
Like I said,
I wanna thank everybody.
Where we going, B? I'm having a good time, man. No, I just got warmed up.
You're done, brother Odev. Cut my man's mic off. I wanna thank everybody for tuning in to the After Party Podcast. Hey, Tyloo, give out your social media.
Hey, y'all can follow me at Tyloo on SoundCloud, Facebook. Oh, man, I know this
nigga. That boy got
man,
a whole bunch of broads in Atlanta.
Hey, bro, I really hope that's
wifey, B. That's wife. You ain't see the J's?
It's like, yo, man, I got a lot of
Where can they follow you at, man? Where can they get the Hawk sauce
yo,
at?
Yo, man, you know, follow me on Instagram, Hawk the Barber Prodigy. You know, I try to follow back. Instagram got this shit going on right now. You can't follow over 7,500 people. Y'all need to fix that shit. If y'all watching this shit, I don't know what the fuck is going on. But yeah, follow me at, you know, on Instagram, Hawk the Barber Prodigy. You know, you can go to my website, hawkthebarberprodigy.com, and, you know, buy products and stuff like that. But yeah, it's your boy.
Hey, man, follow the After Party Podcast, After Party_podcast on Instagram, Facebook. Follow me, After Party E, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat,
talk with his hands
all that.
Like,
hey,
he
that's,
what
I'm saying. Hey, that's that smooth talk. Listen, hey, man,
boy,
I promise, yo, Hawk will never be on this shit again. Yo, After Party Podcast, man, fuck.